So let's see. The room's a little light, and I presume that other people are going to like wander in. But nonetheless, I don't want to let things go too long because I know other people have other places on campus to be and other things to do. Bonnie was meant to be here doing this, but Bonnie's off sick today, so instead you're lumbered with me. But I am very pleased in her place to be able to introduce Dr. Veronica Barassi from Goldsmiths. For those of you who are not familiar, so Goldsmiths is one of the constituent colleges of the University of London. It specializes, I would say, in sort of like design, arts, and humanities. A lot of interesting things that sort of cross over in those boundaries. Those of you in HCI might know Bill Gaver and his work in the design school there, but there's also a lot of very interesting work going on in sociology, cultural studies, and media arts, and sort of at those, you know, in those sort of intersections. So it's a really sort of interesting place that you should be on your radar or on your geography of your intellectual geography. Veronica is an anthropologist and works on the anthropology of media, digital ethnography, a lot of sort of design work, has done work in sort of social media and political activism. But has been working especially over the last couple of years on projects looking at sort of data and the home and data and families. And so she's going to talk to us today on sort of like reflections on big data and artificial intelligence in the home. And I'll leave it to you.
Thank you so much. Well, first of all, I wanted to thank Bonnie, even if she's not here, for inviting me over. I'm delighted to be here. It's been kind of a bit of an ordeal to actually get here, but I'm actually very happy to be here at the moment. So what am I going to be talking about today is about automated homes. Well, I'm talking about the connected home, how if you, also your own homes, or if you actually enter into a normal family home today, or an ordinary family home, you would be confronted with this kind of almost radical technical transformation that is happening, and that it's happening at a quite great speed. And of course, as you might know and as you might have followed, the industry is jumping on that. And in the last couple of years, we have seen the big four, Amazon, Apple, Samsung, and Google, trying to invest as much as possible on home technologies, right? So this is what I'm trying to. What I'm interested in is that today is in exploring this techno-social and techno-historical transformation that we are experiencing. But I'm going to be doing, of course, if you think about it from a social scientific point of view, when you want to understand this type of transformations, there are so many different angles that you can actually take. And especially in the field of artificial intelligence, there's some fascinating research emerging on the ethics of artificial intelligence, the way in which, like for instance, Hello Barbie or Amazon Alexa are actually trying to transmit specific cultural values or specific understandings of the world. Again, there is a lot of research that can be done on the way in which it's changing, the way in which we collect our information, right? So one thing with Amazon Echo, for instance, that it's actually quite interesting is the fact that up until now we were using mostly Google, and we would kind of look through different type of answers, right? You have your keywords and you can, but now what Alexa does is just kind of replies you immediately what your answer, you know, it's like what happened in 1945, and it's like at the end of the Second World War in Europe, you know, so you don't have this. So there is a lot of research questions that we can ask when we're thinking about the home and we were thinking about automated homes. What am I, obviously each researcher is interested in a particular perspective, but what I'm actually interested in is to understand the relationship between automated home and social change with reference to the question of data. If we think about the inclusion of artificial intelligence technologies and smart technologies in the home, we quickly realized that to function these technologies and also their business models, they need to gather, process, and exploit significantly amount of highly personalized and highly contextualized forms of data, right? So it's not just simple data, it's just a really, really personal data. And also related to the context. And as if you have read some of the bits of, in the works on developing artificial intelligence, this is one of the main issues at the moment. How do you get that understanding, right? So one thing that I'm actually interested in is what's happening to the family home when we talk about this collection of highly personal and highly contextualized data. Also, what are the challenges and discrepancies that there are between machines that are collecting something out of the context and that are making assumptions about us? But also, what are the implications for privacy and for the lived experience of people? And finally, what are the social implications for the data future? So how can we think about this, what's happening here and now, with reference to the future? So with that reference to people's future. So just to give you a little bit of background about where I come from, okay? Paul has already introduced Goldsmith. This is Goldsmith, and this is actually our main college. It's a very much smaller campus than yours. And this is our media department. And this year, the media department has been ranked 8th in the world. So it's actually, in terms of communication studies, it's a really, really excellent hub of excellent people. And not because I'm of course biased, but actually we have been awarded that recognition as well. I come from a very different, well, I'm a Goldsmith bred and born and bred, basically, because I did my PhD in the anthropology department at Goldsmith. And then I left for a couple of years to go to Regent's University, which is always in London. But then I was called back within the media department, first as at a fixed term, and then I've been given tenure, like after a couple of years, right? So, and my research, and actually in the media department, I convened the BA Anthropology and Media degree program, which is a 3-year program that brings together anthropology and media, okay? So, my research basically comes from anthropology, but it's always been connected to what people in the media department do, which is pretty much media studies, media communication studies. Much of the media department is very much concerned with critical social theory. So we're talking about actually the development of critical knowledge and so on. So that's how I've been playing around at the intersection of all these different disciplines that have informed my own research. And now, but in the last 10 years, really, I've been working, my key question that I was really interested in, it was about digital culture, but also our engagement with digital culture in relationship to the to participation, to how we participate to society. So actually the way in which we use technologies to participate in society to create something meaningful out of our engagement with society. And I've been working a lot for this reason in the field of social movements and political activism. A lot of my publications have been always in that field and dealing with questions about digital citizenship. But in the last couple of years, as Bo was saying, something in my life changed significantly, which in terms of theoretical understanding. So, and this was a very personal change, but it was also very kind of research-based change, which was an increased awareness that we were experiencing a significant transformation in the way in which we participated within society through technologies. And this significant transformation was determined by the fact that most of our data was collected from a very, very, very early age and shared and exploited, right? So, and that's how I started to kind of become really interested in rethinking ideas of digital citizenship and digital participation. So whilst in the past, when you talk about this digital citizenship, it's always been understood as a very positive term, but it's always been termed as a term that enabled people to participate in society through the use of technologies. Now, what we are actually experiencing is that we are all forced to participate in society through the use of technologies, because our data is literally digitized, shared, stored, analyzed, exploited for us by others. And this is especially in relationship to children and to the individual that is born into the new world. And it was at this time that I actually started, it was 2015, and I started kind of developing the idea that we were living in an age in which our digital participation was in fact cursed. It was no longer voluntary, it was something that we were actually coerced into doing into participating by others, but or by the technological transformations of our societies. So I started. So basically, it was then that I actually started to move away from the field of activism and to start focusing on family life and family data. Right now, if we actually look back at the history, most of Western history, the exploitation and the use of family data is, of course, not new. It's something that's been there for a really long time, and that it's very much connected to the rise of social statistics, but also the kind of like, if you think about earlier institutions like the institution of the census during the Greek, Roman, and Assyrian time. Most of this civilization, they actually recorded the data of the family. That's what they wanted to do. And there was something extraordinarily interesting from a cultural perspective about recording this data. It was that they would record the data to actually make sure that they identify which were the citizens. So effectively, so for instance, during the Roman times, only the man could, the husband could list himself as a citizen on the census, and then he would have to list all the women, slaves, and everyone in his family, and he would be recognized as a citizen, and that would acquire automatically some rights. He would, you know, it's not that it was a one-way process, right? And also, there was something interesting about the idea of the census at the time, and that has a lot to do with what's happening at the moment, which is the issue of surveillance. Now, the censors usually were people that were actually chosen because they were really moral, like they considered moral agents. And the idea of censorship, it was the idea that actually they would constantly surveil the data of the people. That's what they did. We acquired your data because like that we can actually frame you as citizens and we're going to surveil your data. There is a lot of connection with what's happening at the moment. But of course, again, the history of surveillance and exploitation of family data needs to be also interconnected to the development of the modern state. And the fact that actually the modern state could not work without the collection of increasingly more specific demographic data of the people, right? So, and that's, which was also all type of data, but it could include also economic data, but also health data and so on. So there was this kind of idea. So when we think about big data, when we think about what we are experiencing at the moment, we are actually experiencing an intensification of a human and cultural processes that was there for a long time, okay? That's, or at least this is how I see it. One of the fundamental transformations, of course, came with the technological innovation, because technological innovation enables the surveillance and the use of data, okay? So, for instance, the work of Clark on data surveillance, but also Lyon on the surveillance society, kind of framed that idea that actually the modern state was reinforced, the surveillance of the modern state of people's habits and uses and behavior was reinforced by kind of rapidly evolving technology, and technology that could enable not only to surveil people's life, but also to surveil their data and to start to make sense of their data. Okay, so this was that. So when we think about this kind of the link and the history of big data in relationship to what happened in the past, we need to see the human processes and cultural processes that share many similarities. But what we also need to see, we need to see the change. We also need to see what actually was new about big data and the creation of big data, but also the. So, and if you think about it, what happened in the last 10 years, it's been that we kind of started to radically, as society, to radically change our attitude toward data. And this change is obviously not linear. It was not only one person or one business or one government that actually did this change. It was a kind of a very kind of uneven change. But I think that the article of Boyd and Crawford, which you surely are familiar with, captures the complexities of the process, because what they argue is that if you look at big data, you're actually looking at different dimensions. Of course, there was a maximization of computer power and algorithmic accuracy. So we were actually, there was a technological innovation, but there was also a analytical dimension. So that our ideas about what knowledge is and how we process knowledge changed very significantly. In the sense that they started businesses and governments started to become much more aware of the fact that if you you should draw on large data sets to make assumptions and create patterns between people. But also, and this is what really interested me, is the mythological dimension. That people were actually really interested in the fact that actually there was a, data could, it was something new. It was something that would radically transform the way in which we operated as society. And in many ways, this was a myth. There was a really strong ideology behind that. So this idea that actually large data sets, they actually offer higher forms of intelligence, higher forms of knowledge, right? So, and you can hear well, all this interconnected dimension, and you can see them in the work of Meyer, Schoenberg, and Cook here in 2013, that they came up with a book, The Big Data Revolution, which was this big book, big title, and that kind of things. And if we read, for instance, this quote, they say, data was no longer regarded as static or stale, whose usefulness was finished once the purpose for which it was collected was achieved. Rather, data became a new, a raw material of business, a vital economic input used to create a new form of economic value. In fact, with the right mindset, data can be cleverly reused to become a fountain of innovation and new services. So there was this kind of, and again, you can see that fountain of new innovation and new services, like you can bring, you know, there, you have to kind of, you can perceive how ideological that is in many ways, right? But of course, the history is not that simple, because we know that there are significant problems in actually producing these large data sets, but not only producing these large data sets, it is also in the way in which these large data sets actually create new meaning, right? So for instance, Boyd and Crawford suggest too often big data enables the practice of apophenia, seeing patterns where none actually exist, simply because enormous quantities of data can offer connections that radiate in all directions, right? So, and this is the other thing, so there's so many different questions that we need to ask, and actually about context, about the intention. So if we have a lot of data sets, especially digital data sets, for instance, imagine Facebook metadata, okay? You have a like here, like that, but how do you actually know why I like this specific thing? So I personally could like the Democratic Party in Italy, which is just because I'm interested in it, or a right wing organization, just because I want to follow what they're doing, not necessarily because that relates to my political views, right? So that's so there is this kind of discrepancy between what actually the digital data is saying about the persons. But what's happening at the moment, a national level, but also international level, is that much of the knowledge that we produce on individuals is created by the interconnection of different assumptions that are taken from their web history, they're taken from their Facebook profiles, and so on. And these people are getting profiled. So how many of you have read the report by the Federal Trade Commission that was published in 2014 about data brokers? None. Sometimes you don't know whether it's something new or something that people already. How many of you know what data brokers are? That's a kind of minority of the group. Basically, during 2014, between 2014 and 2015. The Obama administration launched, asked Podesta to launch an inquiry into big data and privacy. And it was a 90-day inquiry. It was, it was a good inquiry in the sense that, for instance, the UK government has never thought about doing that. So there was a, but what came out of this inquiry was a different type of reports about the relationship between civil rights, privacy, and data, okay? And but one of the reports was about data brokers, and what What the report is suggesting is that there are around 15 companies that are acting as data brokers. So they're basically selling, they're basically aggregating and they're reselling data about us, right? But the problem is that we don't know as consumers that data brokers are collecting our data. So it works a bit like your credit score, but you don't know what's happening because there's no transparency in the fact that that is happening. And in the report from the Federal Trade Commission, so I'm not talking about the radical tech collective that is actually upset about this. I'm talking about like really kind of more mainstream thinking. There is this knowledge that actually what's happening at the moment is that data brokers profile people in ways that could actually effectively harm them in a material world. So, and I took the quote from the report saying, marketers could even use the seemingly innocuous inferences about consumer in ways that raise concern. While data brokers have a data category for diabetes interests, that manufacturer of sugar-free products could use to offer product discounts. An insurance company could use that same category to classify a consumer as higher risk. And they make a lot of examples like this. But what's also really interesting is that usually if you actually classify as diabetes interest, you're classified as diabetes interest because you have done a research on diabetes, right? Also, you've done a web search on diabetes. But my question is, what happens when, imagine if you had a friend who was terribly hypochondriac, and she's like, oh, I want to know what's wrong with diabetes, you know, if I have diabetes too. It could happen, that's what human interaction is about. And you're having dinner and you're like, oh, let me check what diabetes type 2 is. So this is actually, your data that you're producing there is actually enabling you to profile you, but with questions about context, about accuracy, about discrepancy, and so on, right? So, this and the social tensions that big data actually cause, right? In this. So this is my introduction, but let's actually get into the home now, right? Let's actually get into what my research is about and how we can actually understand these questions within the home. Of course, at the moment, as I mentioned before, like, again, the businesses are jumping on this new market. There is so much technological innovation in this field. And there's a lot of experimentation in this field, right? So, and what's happening at the moment is actually the quick understanding that context does matter. Especially if you create technologies that are home-based technologies, context is everything. It's really important. You have to get that understanding, deep, thick, that's the ethnographic, thick understanding of what's happening in the family home to really develop that. And it's, don't know again, if you've read The Building Jarvis, did you read The Building Jarvis of Mark Zuckerberg? Mark Zuckerberg last year, he always sets himself some goals, which is interesting. Every year he has a new goal. So last year his goal was to create an A system for his home. And he kind of documented all his, he discussed his attempt to try to build that system and the challenges that he faced while he was building that system within the home. And one thing that he actually discusses in this Facebook post is the issue of context. Because he said, you know, understanding context is important for any AE. For example, when I tell Lit to turn on the AC up in my office, that means something completely different from when Priscilla tells it the exact same thing. That one caused some issues. So he's kind of, it's almost, you know, like it's all about the building of his persona, of course, and he kind of shares a lot of personal information about Priscilla and Beast and Max and how, you know, the creation of the system was, you know, would wake up Max in the, so there was this, it's a kind of, it's an interesting text to read in that sense. But what actually is interesting is the fact that actually what we're talking here is not only about simple data. We're actually talking about extraordinarily contextualized forms of data that you have to know. You have to know how the family operates. You have to know how the what's the difference between what type of temperature maybe the Priscilla would want and the one that Mark would want. You have to know exactly how the family dynamics are. And this is very evident if you read, for instance, another extract from an interview with Wolfek, who's she's worked on the creation of Hello Barbie, and together with Mattel. So Toy Talk has actually partnered with Mattel to do Hello Barbie. And what she says is like, Hello Barbie should always know that you have two moms and that your grandma died. So don't bring that up. And that your favorite color is blue and that you want to be a veterinarian when you grow up. So again, think about not only the amount of data that that system needs to have, but also the complexity of gathering that type of data and you know, and creating it and designing it into a product, right? So when we think about context, then we actually realize that in the family home, research, ethnographic research is very much needed. And why would a thick ethnographic research, but also in, at any level, like in terms of, in relation to big data and the emergence of big data, and I'm thinking about Tom's article on big data as well, that that's kind of the idea that actually ethnography really matters today more than ever. But why would it, in the family context, why would it really matter a thick ethnographic understanding? Well, first of all, because you understand the appreciation of the cultural variety and the context, so you would be able to actually really kind of enter into the particularity of everyday home. And this is a novel. I know that I shouldn't be citing novels, but who cares? Ginsburg, in 1963, she's actually an Italian writer. And in 1963, she wrote this book about family language, and the fact that it's a really interesting story about war times and fascism in Italy and so on. But she was actually talking about how, despite all the distance between her family members, what united them was their family lexicon, and they had specific ways of saying things that it was just down to their family. There was no other families were doing that. And it's actually quite a very kind of rich, interesting book in that second sense. But so this is the understanding that all families change and all families have their lexicon, their dynamic, they have their family home structure in very different ways, right? But ethnography matters in that sense, in the sense that we can actually look at the cultural variety and we can actually look at the context and really appreciate the richness of human interaction and the context of human interaction, okay? The other thing that is very important with ethnography is that the ethnography is very interesting because it really kind of unpacks the tension between business models and the actual technological use. So for instance, in 2012, I wrote a piece with a colleague, Emiliano Trere, which actually looked at ideas, business models, ideas of Web 2.0 or Web 3.0, and how they actually assumed what specific practices, how people would use those technologies by either being more participative or more collaborative and so on. And how actually what happened on the ground, it was that people were using social media accounts in completely non-participatory ways and in completely like Web 1.0 ways. So, and all the article goes on like that about the importance of practice. But this is pretty much the why ethnography matters, because we have ideas about what technologies should do, but in actual fact, people use them in very, very, very different ways. And also, there is a kind of a human disconnection between the technology and the experience of technology, the technological ideal and the experience of the. But again, and this is pretty much what I really believe, is that ethnography also matters because ethnography can highlight the social implications and challenges of technological innovation in political ways, by highlighting the risks, by bringing in questions about ethics, about regulation, about many different aspects, right? And it does so in a very kind of rich way, in the sense that it actually shows the social tensions that emerge when people use those technologies. So the things that people are actually afraid of, the things that people are concerned with, how they actually shape their technological use because they want to limit specific outcomes, yeah? So that's why, like, ethnography matters. And of course, I'm definitely not the only one talking about ethnography with in the time of big data. But at the moment, we have a lot like we have a kind of two different fields, especially media anthropology, or if we can talk about media anthropology or media ethnography, or whatever. They are actually kind of interacting in some ways, but they're doing two different things. On the one hand, we have scholars that are actually interested in looking at the relationship between ethnography and data, in the sense of like the production of knowledge. And don't forgive me if I'm no, it's not like, but it's just like it's what that this is a major concern that actually that we're talking about what type of knowledge our society is relying on. And how ethnographic knowledge is much, could integrate that knowledge or could or relates to that knowledge, right? So it's a question of knowledge. And then you have other people who are actually working more on the everyday datafication of experience. So on like kind of looking at they have created research projects on looking at how data is shaping everyday life and so on. So. So this is what's happening at the moment when we talk about data ethnographies, right? So when I started kind of, again, when I came from my political activism moment and I decided, oh, actually, digital citizenship is being transformed, I really want to understand what's happening in the home and how people relate to data. The way, what I designed this project that actually, it was a project that works between London and Los Angeles. So it like, covers families in London and Los Angeles. And the question of actually doing comparative research, it was motivated by the fact that I think that especially issues of big data and how we are accepting or not accepting this technological transformation, they are, at the moment, they are played significantly at international level. So if I actually stayed only in London, it would have been completely limiting for me in the sense that I wouldn't have had an entire perspective of what's happening here. And also the technological speed here is a bit different in regard with the UK. And yeah, no, I was about to do a joke from that for myself these days. Anyway, but there is that kind of, the idea was to actually kind of compare families in the UK and families here. But again, I wanted to break down the national division. And I kind of chose to see this because of their multicultural, multinational, and multi-ethnic backgrounds, right? So in both cities, I've been interviewing parents and I've been working with families at a very, very who belong to very different backgrounds and also national backgrounds with different passports. It could be Brazilian, it could be Indian, it could be Mexican, it could be Italian. There were so many different nations, and I did that on purpose because that's what I wanted to kind of grasp the multiculturality of the two cities. And the project basically is based on has four dimensions. I've been I'm still working on many of these research gathering methods, but I've been focusing a lot on one-to-one, one-hour interviews, qualitative interviews, a simple one. And I'm planning to gather up to 50, and at the moment I've gathered up to 38. I also chose 10 families, and with them I do a much more broader ethnographic project, which actually combines the solo interview, 9 months of digital ethnography, and a self-interview. So I don't know if you're familiar with the self-interview, but it's a method. It's a method that is used to basically you actually ask people to talk to an audio recorder for a period of time, like half an hour or so on, and it's actually really interesting because you're not mediating what they want to talk about. So you just say, talk about your relationship to data. Okay, so that's what I'm doing, and then I've been doing. Well, kind of a platform analysis slash qualitative data analysis, analysis, qualitative textual analysis of the different main technologies used and their data policies. So to actually look at the discourses of the data policies, what's hidden there, what do they tell you about the use of children's data and so on. And I'm planning to launch three focus groups as well with visual mapping about data use. And the way in which I'm actually structuring the data collection is around four main ideas. First of all, I'm actually really interested in understandings of technological change, but actually really biographical understanding of technological change. So I asked people to talk to me about not only how they remember, if they remember the internet arriving, and I'm talking only to parents. I'm not working with children. I'm just working with parents. So to remember how internet technology came, became a home technology, and getting really like interesting accounts on broadband and wireless and so on. But also then I asked them whether they perceived in the last 10 to 15 years a change in the way societies is collecting data and in that understanding of data, and what do they know about the big data revolution per se or so on, and how did they experience it? So it's all about the biographical experience of this transformation, and that's the first part of the interview. Then I asked them also, and the focus group as well, I have some elements of this. I asked parents to imagine a Saturday, and a Saturday is a non-working day, so they don't have any excuse to actually go online. That it's not a working excuse, right? And I tell them, and I usually, it's very interesting when you talk to the families that I've been working with, if you talk with the wife or the husband, they have completely different understandings of what's happening there. But I ask them to talk me through the entire digital routine. So what do? They wake up and they pick up their phone, and what do their children do? What does their wife or husband or partner does? And so on, right? And actually, I have this kind of map of the day, of the Saturday, and how much use there is. And then we move to imagining what data flows are produced through that constant connection within the home. And finally, I ask them about to imagine their future. Then to imagine a future home and to imagine the future of the data, well, the future of the data futures of their children, right? So what implication they think the data that they produce today might have on the future of the children and so on. So, and the idea of the future is actually really interesting because from an anthropological point of view, because you kind of really grasp two things. You grasp the enthusiasm and you grasp the excitement, but you grasp also the anxiety and the fear, and that it's connected to the imagination. But also the other thing is that it's very interesting at anthropological level is how imagination is linked to action. So many times when we imagine things, and this is Tim Engel speaking, so many times when we imagine things, we imagine things in a particular way as to take action in that way. You know, that's what's happening, right? So that's why I kind of give that. So these are the four dimensions that I've been working on. And what I found out, it was that actually, during the average, not only during the average, but during an average family week, the amounts of data produced within from the family home are impressive. And it's very personalized and very contextualized form of data. So I kind of decided, I have like this kind of big map about what the type of map, we have a lot of different type of data that is collected through social media narratives, but that data can be like about political affiliation, about health, about education, about anything, values in general, gender narratives, and so on. And this is only children's data, I'm mapping, right? Mobile apps. Parents have a lot of apps that regulate their home. So they can be smart technologies apps, but they can be baby apps, pregnancy apps, that they can be dead apps in the sense that they downloaded these apps like 5 years ago and they never deleted it, and the apps are just there to collect data still. So there is all this, and there's a lot of data coming like about contacts, about location, but also a lot of biometrical data that comes from the mobile apps and so on. You have everyday practices and behaviors that is collected, type of data that is collected again through different devices. It depends, like it could be like kind of the through social media narrative, but it could be also through smart technology. So when you got into the home, when did you deactivate your security system, when you activated, blah blah blah. You have technologies gathering increasingly more, and this is actually in the Facebook development, in the building Jarvis post that Mark Zuckerberg talks about, the importance of voice and facial recognition. At the moment, most of the technologies rely on like a much more sophisticated system for voice and facial recognition. And of course, and this is just talking about the family home, but during a family week, what people actually do is actually they share large quantities of digital data that is collected through bills, it's collected through their health system, it's collected through the education system, and so on. So when we talk about automated homes, the way in which I see it is that we can't really understand automated homes without understanding the complexity of extremely datafied families, okay? Now, what am I finding out? Well, I've actually, this time around, I decided to actually be completely democratic with my research findings. And you know, like, I don't know why, but the researchers can be very kind of, well, I know why. There many researchers are concerned about being, you know, like ideas being taken or things like that. One colleague of mine changed my perspective of things at a certain point because he told me once, you know, ideas, nobody really owns the idea. Like, it's like in academia, it's the importance of sharing. So at the moment, I have launched the Child Data Citizen website. And actually, I have like kind of pretty long summaries of my research findings and what I'm actually finding whilst I'm in the process of gathering the data. So if you're interested, you can look at this one. But for today, I want to talk about like three fundamental findings that I found by working with families and by thinking about the automated homes, right? The first one is how the automated home is changing family life. And it's changing family life in very kind of interesting and significant ways, right? But also how this change is very unlinear. So when you talk to the industry, you always have this idea that actually now all the homes are going to be automated and everything. But the speed of change is very different from family to family, and it really depends on people's cultural values and beliefs, and in their appreciation of technologies, right? But so far, what was fascinating it was when I was talking to parents, and the parents especially that use technologies, automated technologies, is this kind of tension between a feeling of reassurance and a feeling of anxiety. So for instance, one day I was doing field work and I was working with this family, and I go into their children's room and I noticed that both beds had a camera on top of them. And I was just like, oh, wow, that's good. And they said, within the home, or is it connected to an app? Is it the type of technology? What type of technology are you using? And I find out that actually it was a surveillance camera that was connected to an app. That actually, and I looked at the data policy of the app, and it was like in normal data policy. So it was not even like some home technologies at the moment are changing their data policies significantly. But it was so I was just like, okay, so you. Let me explain, let me understand this. So you have two cameras right on top of the beds of your children, and you're not worried? I say, no, actually, it gives me a sense of reassurance, because like that I can follow what's going on in their bedroom. And so we go on and talk, and this is where what's interesting at the moment working with families, that people feel reassured of using certain technologies, and then they feel like anxiety about completely different type of technologies, and so for instance, she was very anxious about smart meters, and how smart meters would predict or would take all the information. And I was just like, that's really interesting. Why would you? Did you read the terms and conditions? No, it was just a bit. Or I had another dad in the UK. This one, where he would share everything on social media about his child, but he would be really, really, really worried about mobile apps, and especially information that was gathered through mobile apps. So he wouldn't have any kind of child-related mobile app, but things like that. And so this is what's fascinating, is that these technologies are coming with a force, they're being used, but they create different levels of enthusiasm and anxiety. And at the moment it's quite unpredictable how this happens, because it's really tied into people's own biographical choices. The other thing that's actually really interesting is that there is a profound disconnection between what business models, well, the automated services are different, but still, those services that are not automated, still there is a big difference between what people actually do with their technologies and what business models think that people do with their technologies. So for instance, self-tracking apps, the majority of families have all used, for instance, pregnancy apps or baby apps to track. And what's fascinating about these apps is that actually they gather and they exploit significant amount of biometrical data. So for instance, mothers would say how many times the baby kicked, they would put the phone on top of the bump to like kind of encapsulate the heart rate, what they ate the day, and so on. So that's like actually a significant amount of data, okay? And what's happening is that, but actually what's actually really interesting is the fact that the way in which this data collected is many times inaccurate. Many times people don't have the time. They don't really want to put that in that information. So for instance, I had this two mothers who were saying, you know, we tried to use the baby app to track what happened after the baby. But then, you know, at the end of the day, it was much easier to talk to each other. And it was just like, so we were sharing the same app, but then, you know, that's what. And so this is something that is actually, and also what's also emerging is that people started becoming increasingly more, when you talk to them about how they relate to the transformation of big data, people are increasingly more aware that companies are using their data, and they're not really comfortable with that. In the majority of cases, they're not. There's some who are, but in the majority of cases, they're not very comfortable. So they're actually developing tactics to not give out that data. So if you use, for instance, an app, they just put a fake name for their child, or they put the, you know. So they kind of start using the app or using the specific technology in very interesting way. But also, what's also interesting that it's actually emerging from the human disconnect between system and experience is the way in which we kind of use technology sometimes. It's very it's very personal, and again, it's very uneven. Okay, so for instance, there was this example of two related fathers. Well, they knew each other, and one father talking about the other father, saying, "Oh, he uses Amazon Echo. You have to talk to him because he uses Amazon Echo. But he can't live without Amazon Echo." And then actually you go and talk to the other father, and the other father is like saying, no, actually I use Amazon Echo only for this element, right? So there's this kind of idea between what people think they do with technologies and what they actually do with technologies as well. So there is another level of disconnect and the level of complexity in the family home that it's emerging. And this is the last bit, and I'm gonna leave you to it. But the other element that I'm actually working on, and I know this is a work in progress, so I'm sorry about this, but this is what I have. But what I'm working, the other element about imagining the future, and actually the enthusiasm and anxieties that emerge when they think about the automated home, is becoming really interesting. Families imagine all types of technologies. When you tell them, imagine the home of the future, they imagine everything. They imagine toilets being able to predict what type of health disorder you have from your urine, or they imagine, I don't know, the windows without curtains, because they would be able to predict automatically what type of light there is and how you want it. Self-washing floors, and this is, I'm not joking, and this is something that needs to be investigated. All the parents I've interviewed have used the example of the milk. And I thought, come on, I mean, what are the chances of that? And they were like, again, they were all very differently culturally, and they lived in two different cities. And all of them would come up with the idea of the milk. And that tells you a lot about what family is and the home and symbols associated to their home. And they came up with the idea, it's like, well, the perfect automated home is the one that actually buys you milk if you run out of milk. But all of them talked about it. And there is some playfulness and joy and enthusiasm that it's that is recorded in this interest in transformation. But there is a lot of there is a great deal of anxiety also that I'm actually recording, which is the idea of total surveillance. The idea that actually you everything you do is going to be completely scrutinized, it's going to be completely recorded, and could be used against you in the future if decontextualized as well. And this is the idea. And also, another thing that is emerging a lot, especially in the last interviews, and you can see that how people actually change their ideas as and how we change it as a society, because it's something that is actually being talked a lot of in the news as well at the moment, which is all about automation. And many of the parents that I've been talking to recently are really worried about how automation will impact on their children's future in the sense of jobs and the fact that they would not be able to find jobs or so on. So there are like, but this is the, this, to conclude, which I don't have a conclusion because I haven't finished the project. But this is what I wanted to convey today was, first of all, an understanding that we can't really talk about automated homes without considering how they're connected to new ideas of datafied families and to new implications about privacy, about civil rights, but also about intrusion of different, because when we talk about, but when we talk about privacy, what we have to understand that it's not only this kind of techno-dystopian vision of Big Brother watching you. It's a question of actually people constantly profile each other on the basis of the digital data that is produced. So employers will go on your digital traces. That's what they do, they've always done it. And education, everybody. So there's this idea that when we talk about digital profiling, we're not only talking about a machine-led process, we're also talking about a very complex human process that it's affecting different dimensions of life. So this is why it's even more interesting to talk about digital traces. And again, the connection between this digital traces and new understanding of digital citizenship. Yeah? So that's so this is the website. Those are pretty much the areas that I'm actually working on. And so if you just want to have a look with some of the findings that I haven't been able to discuss today, and anything, and if you want have any questions, just write to me or ask them now.
Thank you very much.
So this was great. Thank you so much. I have a couple of questions. Maybe I'll just do just one just now. I'm interested in, on the one hand, there's this notion of total surveillance that sort of comes up in the question of the ways in which sort of digital traces are left behind. But the other thing that's kind of always intriguing about sort of the current context of Internet of Things and smart homes is the introduction of a fragmentation inside the house, right? Between the data that the data that Google has, the data that Amazon has, the data that Apple has, the data that various other providers have, that actually don't flow easily, right? And that are generated in my interaction with very different kinds of providers. And I wonder how people think about the pragmatics of that. Now, maybe they're not, I mean, they're not they're thinking about it through a different set of lenses, but I'm intrigued as to how that manifests itself as a notion of total surveillance, even in the face of the pragmatic challenges of getting data to move from one place to another.
I think this is the problem. That when they talk about total surveillance, it is more about the future. So what the things that actually are coming up that are the fears is whether the digital data will be integrated to, for instance, the social security number or the national insurance number in the UK. So, and this is a big question. And I know that there's been some developments also, although there's a lot of writing about some of these developments in China of connecting most of your digital data to your social security, well, the equivalent of the social security number, which I have no idea how it's called, but to the, which is the idea of the citizen score. So, but again, it's still, if you read the literature or the articles around the citizen score in China, it's still a bit you don't really understand what's happening really and how accurate it is that all the data is integrated. So, but I think when they talk about total surveillance, they're talking about the misuse or the integration of that data into a much more government-driven type of understanding. And when they talk about the total surveillance in reference with the fragmentation of it, I think that something that is actually emerging at the moment that is actually interesting is the knowledge that because there is that fragmentation and because all the data that is collected is fragmented anyway, that all you can't actually make an accurate prediction of what the fact. And I think that that's more maybe the total surveillance term was wrong in the slide in a sense because that's more the anxiety. The actual anxiety that people are going to make assumption about me. About something that it's completely decontextualized. And we all know, I mean, we all study, we know what the implications of the contextual knowledge is. And so that's the kind of thing. So I think that's what Rory is. But I think, but and actually it's interesting because in the Zuckerberg argument on his post on building Jarvis, he was pretty much talking about that disconnection in relationship to home technologies. So he was saying, it's very difficult to actually create an automated home because I didn't have a way to actually connect the different technologies because they were all from different providers and so on. But yeah, but so that's.
Thanks.
I thank you for the presentation. Partly, I was really interested in the example of the parents with the two cameras, and the question of their own surveillance practices on their children. So there's a lot, there's so many new technologies to surveil your kids from just the, you know, the baby monitor up to, you know, I know Buick right now is advertising that you can, when you give the car to your kids, you can figure out where they're going. Okay, so is there any way of getting, so we do different kinds of surveillance.
Yeah.
Are those sites in which parents are also thinking about, so they're watching their kids, and there's new technologies that enable that. Who's watching them surveil their kids? Is there any connection between what is it like? What it means to be able to connect data? Because they're doing part of it themselves.
Yeah. No. Like I mean, I think that there is. Are you familiar with Andrejevic stuff? Andrejevic wrote precisely about that idea, okay. The practices of close surveillance, right? So the fact that actually that. We live in an area whereby we are constantly pushed towards a system of close surveillance. But he refers a lot about social media websites. And the truth is that it's very difficult because like I think that for the people that were not many of the parents were using nanny cams or camera cams. Right. This is the first thing actually. I actually expected that many of them would kind of have all the cameras, but it was actually quite limited. Very few families use them, and that's one thing that I think I have to do. They do use baby monitors and baby monitors that are connected to the camera, but not like the proper system connected to the app, and that you could actually access from your phone, right? But the thing is that what I found is that people felt reassured. That people were, they just felt reassured. So they didn't even kind of contemplate the fact that they were surveilled. They didn't think about it as something bad, right? And the question is, and this is something I was having a chat a few, I think in May last year, with Sonia Livingston, who works a lot on digital parenting. And she was just saying, well, I don't know if the technologies are actually making parents more anxious, or if it's because parents are anxious that they kind of turn to the technologies. This is something that actually needs to be looked at. But I haven't had enough data to actually look at that practice of close surveillance in the family, unfortunately, because it didn't come up, and that's what Anthropology got. Yeah.
So I study parenting too and technology in some ways. But what's fascinating to me, one of the things is that I don't think it's that parents are more or less anxious. I think that the technology provides certain capacities that once it exists, you become a default parent by ignoring it. So the sense that like in a different era, if my kid, you know, something happened to them, there was nothing I could do about it. But now, the sense that because I can watch them, I feel more that I would be at a loss.
Yeah.
I would be, it would be a lacking
yeah.
parent if I didn't. So there's like, the capacity shifts the moral accountability
yeah.
to the child in a way that we haven't really thought through. And parent, yeah, there's another layer of guilt there. Or potential layer of guilt.
I think you're right, actually.
I didn't think about
it in that terms because I like it was not something. But I think you're right. It might be that. But it's
often with older children and texting and whether or not that I should be know where they are at all times.
But that's. I think it, that's you're right, absolutely. And like adding a level in the dimension of guilt, but also what is actually really interesting is. The tensions between parents this is creating. So for instance, because it started to become like a proper, like it's a bit like all the educational things are all about, it's all health food or not healthy food. It's all, you know, it's like, it's sleep training or not sleep training. So there is all this kind of really, and what's happening at the moment is actually really much about parents saying, oh, I'm not doing this for my child and I'm doing that for my child. And there is a kind of, so the people that might be feeling guilty, but there's a lot of people that actually make a mission out of that. So I had a family in the UK, for instance, who were telling me that they were the only one in the school. Actually, no, it was them and a couple of others, but there were few parents out of majority who didn't want any type of recording within the school. And they didn't want to be, you know, like they didn't want the information of the children posted on social media. And they were really adamant about that. And because there is a right, you have to sign the so this, they decided. So for that reason, the school play was all the parents were couldn't film their school play. And that caused a massive havoc in the school because everybody was saying, yeah, it's your fault. Why did you do it? You know, like why? You? So, and I think, so there is there's definitely an element of guilt, but there's also an element of people that are starting to take specific positions and there is a tension going on there, I think,
for sure.
It's happening.
Yeah.
But it's just so new that we don't really know it. So
yeah.
That's you wanted to stop us, right?
No, I just was I'm not going to stop anything, but I mean
moving us.
Since
yeah.
we have a reception downstairs where there's an opportunity for more discussion and more questions and since other people might have to leave, I'll take this opportunity to thank Veronica again.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.